Hey everyone, the first thing we need to do is get the deployment parameter spreadsheet. There are two ways to do that. One is through the Customer Connect website where we got the Cloud Builder appliance from. I won't repeat that process. The second is from the Cloud Builder appliance itself. Now, once you've logged in, all you need to do is click on I have reviewed, click next, and then click that big download button, and that's it. That's the deployment parameter spreadsheet.
Once you have the deployment parameter spreadsheet open, you'll see that there are four tabs. The first tab is just informational. Then you've got credentials, hosts and networks, and deploy parameters. All three of these tabs require information to be input.
I wanted to point out a quick fact that may not be commonly known. The deployment parameter spreadsheet is organized in a way so that the appropriate discussions can be had with the respective personas. You've got the networks team, who would focus on the hosts and networks, as well as the deploy parameters tab. You've got the security team, who would likely focus on the credentials as well as the hosts and networks tab. And finally, you've got the VI admin, who may overlap amongst all tabs, but would probably more specifically spend their time in the deploy parameters tab.
I've pre-filled this spreadsheet so that way it makes it easier to talk to in credentials. To make this easier, I've just put everything as the same password. The one thing you do need to make sure though is with your root account for your ESXi hosts, they all need to be the same for the first four hosts in the management domain. Otherwise, you can't do the bring up because it only gives you one field to put in the password for the host accounts. We've got vCenter SSO account as well as the root account, NSX root admin and audit, SDDC manager root VCF and admin account. I won't go through what each of those accounts actually do in this case, but just know that this is where the passwords for those accounts are configured. Next tab, we've got hosts and networks. We've got the ability to modify certain settings here, not all settings, so I'll walk you through which ones you can. In the top right here, we've got management domain network. You can change the VLAN numbers for the networks. You've got the manager network, the vMotion network, and the vSAN network. The port group name can also be changed. I've left this as close to the example as possible. Then you've got the site annotations to fill out, the gateway details. And then the MTU I generally leave as default. You don't need to change it as long as you can meet those requirements in your network. To the right of that, we've got the management domain ESXi hosts. In my case, I've put in reg1, host1, 2, 3, and 4. Whatever you've named these in your environment, just change them to suit. It's essentially just the DNS short name of the DNS record that you've created for each of these hosts. Underneath are the IP addresses assigned to each of these hosts in my DNS record, 10.0.0, 10, 11, 12, and 13, as you can see here. You can see that it fits within the management network. The management VM kernel for each of these hosts will be configured with those IP addresses. Underneath, you can see the vMotion start and end IP, and the same with the vSAN start and end IP. What this is going to do is configure all of the hosts with an IP for each VM kernel for the vSAN and vMotion respectively on each host in those IP ranges. It should do them sequentially. Host 1 should get 10.0.1.10, 2 should get 11, and so on. Then we've got virtual networking, the initial vSwitch name, which is already on the host by default. You don't really need to change this. Then you've got the primary VDS or vSphere distributed switch name. In this case, I've changed it to reg1vds01, then the NICs that I want to use on the host for that VDS. In my case, it's 4 and 5. In yours, it may be 0 and 1, 1 and 2, whatever it may be. You just need to populate that to suit your environment. Underneath, the MTU size, generally you leave that as well. That's 9K by default. And then you've also got the secondary VDS. We'll walk through what you use that for. Below profiles, for example, you've got 3 VDS profiles that you can choose from. The first one is simply put just a single VDS. It'll actually tell you here what each one does. Profile 1 is a single VDS with between 2 or 4 PNICs, and then all traffic sits on this. So the vSAN, vMotion, management, host overlay, and so forth. That'll all be on a single VDS. Now, at some point, if you ever wanted to split those functionalities between different PNICs, there are certain profiles you can choose from. So profile 2, in this case, I will just name this VDS2. What this VDS profile allows you to do is all the traffic outside of vSAN will remain on the first VDS, then all vSAN traffic will be on the second VDS, and then you just map additional NICs, similar to how you did previous example. So you'd go, for example, VMNIC2 and VMNIC3. Then MTU size, again, set it accordingly. typically it's 9,000. So that's what profile 2 does. And profile 3 is similar, but not at the same time. You've got, again, two VDSs. The first VDS in this case will have all traffic, including management, vSAN, and vMotion. And the second VDS will be completely just for NSX overlay traffic. That's all your tunnel endpoint traffic. That's in a nutshell what the three profiles do. In this example, I'm just going to go with a single VDS. Before we move on, we've got host overlay networks and security thumbprints to cover. The security thumbprints, essentially, if you want to validate the thumbprints, what that does is all connectivity to the hosts is secured from the initial connection onwards. And if you say no, the initial connection is unsecured, but then it authenticates and then secures all the subsequent connections. If you do select yes, you will have to go and pre-fill all the SSH RSA key fingerprints for each host. That's all that the difference is. In this case, I'm going to keep it simple and not validate and move on. Finally, on this page, or in this tab, I should say, you've got how you're going to assign the tunnel endpoint IP addresses to the hosts. First off, assign the VLAN. In this case, it's VLAN 16. As I mentioned earlier, you've got the ability to either use a static pool or DHCP. DHCP is default. Once you define the VLAN ID, you don't need to select DHCP. But if you do want to use an IP pool, you just have to say yes and then define the IP pool requirements. Finally, we've got the deployed parameters tab. Some simple information here, DNS servers and NTP servers, populate them to suit your environment. I've only got one server that does both functions in my environment, but you may have two, so you can fill both out there. The DNS zone domain name is the root zone domain name.
If you've created a specific DNS zone for VCF, enter that in here instead.
In my case, it's just shank.com. I haven't filled in the license keys here for some obvious reasons, but before you can actually save and use this worksheet, all of the license keys need to be pre-filled, which I will do once I stop this recording. Then we've got the vCenter details. The VM name in this case is going to be VC01 with an IP address of 10.0.0.100. It's going to be small. The storage size is going to be default. On the right, you can see the vSAN configuration. In this case, the name is RegDSVSAN01, and I'm not going to be enabling deduplication or compression. If you do require those, tick yes, but then there are caveats around those, so the performance and overhead that will incur. Then we've got the data center and cluster names. All of this is stuff you can configure. EVC, I won't go into great detail about what EVC is, but if you've got mixed match CPUs with lower and higher generations, if you need to build a cluster in that case, it's not really recommended. You can select the lowest EVC setting. That way the entire cluster can be used and vMotion will work without an issue. In my case, I won't be enabling it. Next, we've got the architecture to be deployed. You've got two choices. There is the standard and then there is the consolidated. What the standard is expecting is that you will have a separate management domain and workload domain. Consolidated is both in one. NSX manager cluster IP addressing. So the first one is the VIP. Subsequent ones are the manager appliances that get spun up, three in a cluster. So there's an IP address for each, as well as the VIP. Remember, all of this that we're talking about here that has an IP address and a name needs a DNS record. Make sure that you've got all of these DNS records already populated to what you're filling out in this spreadsheet. Then you've got the SDDC manager name and IP address. Again, DNS record, network pool. Name is just the network pool that's defined for vSAN and vMotion in SDDC manager, and that doesn't go anywhere else really. Finally, you've got the Cloud Foundation management domain name, which is the entire SDDC, what you're going to be calling. That's your spreadsheet done. Hopefully by now, you've got a good understanding of the deployment parameters spreadsheet. Seeing as it's essentially infrastructure as code, you can also achieve the same outcomes with a JSON file. It's a good idea to keep this in mind, especially if you've got more than four management hosts and you would like to build them up all at the same time. You're not limited by the four nodes as you are in the spreadsheet. I know I harped on a lot about DNS. It is very important with VCF, but NTP is equally as important, so make sure you've got that right as well. If you found this video useful, please hit like, subscribe, and comment. It does help me out to know that I'm on the right track. I do want to help you as much as possible. Now, this is the third video in this series. If you've missed the first one on VCF architecture, click here to get an overview of what it actually is. And if you've missed and want to see more about the Cloud Builder appliance, click here and I'll be able to take you through that in that video. Thanks for watching.